Good day, everyone. I'm Denisa Fernandez, reporter for INQUIRER.net. Welcome to another episode of INQside Look. Today, former Department of Agrarian Reform Secretary and senatorial aspirant John Castriciones joins us to talk about his senatorial bid. Hi, Sir John. Thank you for joining us in this interview. How are you, po?
I'm fine, Danisa. Thank you so much for this opportunity to be heard. And I'm very glad because I know that INQUIRER has a lot of viewers, and I hope that they would be able to have the opportunity to hear my 10-point platform. Thank you, Danisa.
Okay, sir. So to start po, may we know po, why did you seek to join the senatorial race po? Is this your plan all along po, sir?
Well, actually not. As a matter of fact, way back 2019, during the midterm election of President Duterte's administration, I was already asked to run for a senatorial position, but I declined because being a Secretary of Agrarian Reform would give me the great opportunity to really touch bases with our farmers and to know more about the agricultural development in our country. So I declined the offer, and of course, to cut the long story short, I had the opportunity to really went around the country even during the height of the pandemic, and I was able to distribute the Certificate of Land Ownership Award, which of course is the zenith of the so-called ambition and dreams of our farmers. But now, at the end of the term of the president, I was offered again the position, or should I say the opportunity to run as a senator for the Republic. And I decided to accept the offer because, you know, I found out that there are a lot of loopholes in the Agrarian Reform Program which need to be improved, need to be corrected. And so there is a need for us to pass a law that will really help and assist our farmers in order to enhance their economic lives. So, but of course, not only the farmers, but all the concerns of our people, of our citizenry, most especially those underprivileged. That is it.
Okay, sir. So may we know a little bit more about the loopholes that you found out for?
Well, in the first place, you know, most of the lands which have been distributed, well, of course, let me start with the figures first. At the start of the Comprehensive Agrarian Reform Program, or should we say the Agrarian Reform Program, as of now, there were already 5 million hectares of land which were distributed. But, you know, out of these 5 million hectares, 1.3 million hectares are actually distributed by collective CLOA. When you say a collective CLOA, it means that there's only one title, or let us say 500 farmers or more or less. So basically, it's just one title for all of these farmers. And so there are a lot of problems that can really arise from this. One is, of course, the fact that the farmers do not know which portion of the land is theirs. So more often than not, it results into bickerings, infightings amongst the farmers. So it does more harm than good. Secondly, they cannot pay their amortizations with land bank. So there is no way that they would be able to own that land because they can never pay their amortization. Why? Because of the lack of the so-called land acquisition distribution information sheet. Number three, the local government units are, of course, at a loss because they cannot recover or they cannot collect the so-called real property tax, which is, of course, supposedly to be shouldered by the new landowners themselves. And number four, which is, of course, I think is the reason why there is really a need for us to correct this injustice, is the farmers cannot borrow loans, financial loans from financial institutions, because most farmers are already disappointed because of the long period of time that they cannot own the land or they cannot even occupy the land. They would just have to leave and go to other professions, or should I say other kinds of businesses, other kinds of activities that will have to make them productive and earn well, money for their families. So all of this should be corrected. That's just one of the flaws. Number two, I think there's a need for us to emphasize on the so-called support services. Because, you know, giving a parcel of land to a farmer is not enough. I'm comparing this situation to a fish that is drawn out of water or a tree that is pulled out from the soil itself. In the same manner that a farmer without a land can never be a true farmer. That's the reason why what I'm saying is that after giving them a piece of land, what we can do is we should give them the so-called support services. What is the support services that can be given to them? Let's say farm machineries, which of course is the concept of modern farming, fertilizers, and other chemical needs in order to improve the quality of the soil and the quality of the plants. Support services in a way wherein you have to give them the so-called irrigation system, because without water, it would be difficult, utterly difficult, for the farmers to become productive in their lands. More especially that there are a lot of lands which are landlocked. In other words, they are just depending on the rains that would come. And fourthly, we need to give them the so-called technical training as well. And also, of course, the values is very important. You know, a lot of us will belittle our farmers, and some of our farmers would lose heart, and they would look down upon themselves as well. They pity themselves. So it is high time that we should have a change of mindset, should I say a mindset, to change our mindset and have a paradigm shift on the importance of our farmers, most especially at the height of this pandemic. We came to realize that without the farmers, we will never be able to survive. All the other professions, probably, should we say, have technically stopped, like teachers, they don't go to schools anymore. Lawyers like myself do not go to courts. Why? Because of the very strict health protocols. The engineers and the architects would have to stop building because of the strict health protocols. But the farmers, they have to silently do their chores, go to the fields, go to the farms, and till the soil so that it will yield fruits, yield the plants that are necessary for a man's survival. Without the food, I'm sure, Danisa, we will all perish and we will have a very problematic and anarchic situation. So it is very important that we should really help our farmers. So these are just some of the so-called analysis that I have in mind in order to help our farmers.
Okay, with those said, sir, did you plan to advocate for farmers? Is that what you like to prioritize po when should you win in the Senate po?
Well, that would be my priority. If fate and destiny would smile at me, Danisa, what I would like to do is to champion the cause of our farmers and agriculture. You know, the first thing that we should bear in mind is that we have a lot of lands that are idle, unused, and utilized. And the fact that we are 60 to 70% involved in agriculture, I mean, citizenry, 60 to 70% of our population is actually engaged in agriculture. But ironically, you know, Danisa, we are still importing rice from other countries. And to think that there was a time when our neighboring countries were actually coming here to the Philippines just to learn the ropes of planting rice, planting palais, but now we are buying from them, ironically. Even the bangus, which is actually locally produced, locally grown in Pangasinan, why are we buying it from Taiwan? So there are laws which need to be passed in order to strengthen, protect, and of course to promote agriculture, and particularly our farmers. And even the ilang-ilang, did you know that we are buying ilang-ilang from other countries now? When in fact, ilang-ilang is locally grown, that is very ironical, Danisa. That's the reason why we must have to have a good perspective of what agriculture is all about. And that is the reason why, in my stint as the Secretary of the Department of Agrarian Reform, I would like that all the sectors of the society must come to appreciate the fact that a country can never be developed, we can never be industrialized, not unless we have a strong and a formidable agricultural sector. And we must have to include the youth here. And that's the reason why I made an administrative order. Did you know, Danny, said that under Republic Act 6657, there's a certain provision there that states that land should also be distributed to our graduates of agriculture courses. But that was never implemented since 1988. It was never implemented. Only now, during the Duterte administration, during my term, that we passed an administrative order wherein if you are an agriculture graduate of a four-year course, and by the end of your term, or I mean by your course, you don't have a piece of land of your own, you can be given as much as 3 hectares to use as your farm laboratory, with the commitment that you will have to train and to pass your knowledge, your technical skills to our farmers who, of course, as we all know, did not formally study agriculture. And we have already started distributing lands to the youth, to these graduates of agriculture. In Cagayan province, particularly in the Cagayan State University, we have distributed hundreds of hectares there. And also in Pampanga State Agricultural University, we have also distributed lands to our agriculture graduates. Also in Palawan and even in Davao, and it's still ongoing. And I hope that this will continue. And I want this to be really institutionalized through a law so that we will be able to really give a momentum of enthusiasm to our youth so that they would participate in agriculture. You know, most of these agriculture graduates, they end up as clerks or as messengers or working on another field other than agriculture. So it's really a waste of effort, time, and knowledge. And, you know, my idea is that I hope I would be given the opportunity and the chance to legislate a law so that we can also give lands to our OFWs. You know, the OFWs, when they come home, they are the people who have the capital, Danisa. But sometimes, along the way, they splurge spending this capital of theirs, and they end up penniless without being productive. Why don't we give them a piece of land? We have so many lands, so to speak. Why don't we give them a piece of land so that they can contribute to the development of our agriculture? Thirdly, what about the poor people in the urban areas? Why don't we give them land so that they would be encouraged to go back to the provinces? You know, there are a lot of problems brought about by the overpopulation in our metropolis, in the cities, all throughout the Philippines. It creates pollution. It creates crimes, drugs, squatters, garbage. It creates a lot of problems. So if we ask our people to go back to the provinces and they will be given a piece of land of their own and they would actively participate in agriculture, I'm sure we would be able to develop, we would be able to realize our dreams of becoming an industrialized country, Danisa.
Okay, sir, so it seems like you have already a lot of projects or measures in mind. But should you win, po, let's say you win in the 2022 elections, what would be the first bill that you would pass? Or you would file, rather?
Well, Danisa, I'd like that we continue the comprehensive agrarian reform program. That's number one. But it should be a new and improved comprehensive agrarian reform program wherein we would expand the coverage. Because as of now, technically, the comprehensive agrarian reform program has already stopped. Why? Given a notice of coverage prior to 2014. So after 2014, there are no more lands acquired by our government for purposes of private lands to be distributed to our farmers. So I'd like to extend it. And I'm sure that would be an opposition coming from people who are landed and people who, you know, who have vast properties. But I think if we want to become a progressive country, we must be able to cooperate with one another. There must be some sacrifices that must be given. There are some sacrifices that must be offered so that we will be able to attain true level and progress in our country. That's number one. And of course, I would like to legislate a law that would have to enhance the support services to our farmers. That is very important. Without support services, our farmers will never be able to enhance their economic lives. When the farmers would have to, would be able to enhance their economic lives, you know, it's just like it will have a domino effect, Danisa. Why? Because other sectors of our society would likewise be given the opportunity to improve their lives. There would be ample food, food sufficiency for everyone. And of course, we can now concentrate on our dreams of becoming an industrialized country. And so that would be my first piece of legislation. But of course, I have other laws in mind, which of course would be federalism, the passage of the Magna Carta for the barangay, the economic recovery program, the trial by jury in order to create the credibility to our courts. Because, you know, we have some people, or most of the people, whenever there is a decision handed down, they would say, ah, nalagyan yan eh, nalagyan yung judge yan, ganyan. Although, in fairness, we have a lot of judges, because as a lawyer myself and as a practitioner in law, I have a lot of dealings with our judges, and they are very honest and credible. But there is a perception, a public perception, that they can be easily bribed, etc. When we adopt the trial by jury, you know, it will definitely restore credibility and integrity to our judicial system, because even the ordinary citizens from all walks of life would be able to participate in the decision making. I would also want, and I advocate for, the creation of an OFW, Department of OFW. And also I would like to have international diplomacy using genuine nationalism. And of course, I'd like to have a passage of a law against political dynasty. And, you know, all of this, I have 10-point program which I would like to start with in the event that I will be smiled at by fate and destiny.
Okay, sir. So thank you for laying out all your plans. But later on, let's talk about some issues on that po. So for now, shifting to a bit more political topic. Who do you think po, or who do you consider as your biggest rivals in the senatorial race po? And what is your edge against him or her po?
Well, sad to say, you know, those senators that are coming back for the position of senators are household names. They have been there for the longest time. And, you know, a lot of our people have been used into having this so-called personality cult. And that is the problem, you know? But I think it is high time that we should try to change our hearts and minds, our perspective, when it comes to politics. You know, I'm advocating for revolution. Did you know that, Darisa? Not the violent one. It's a revolution of the heart and the mind. I wrote a book which is entitled Internal Revolution. It was endorsed by some of my friends who are Jesuit priests. And you know, my advocacy is there must be a revolution which is internal, a change of heart and a change of mind, so that people will eventually be able to acknowledge and recognize the concept of true and genuine change. You know, we can only change a system if we have changed our hearts and our minds, if we have good values and virtues, and that is my advocacy. I hope that we would be able to change our hearts and minds so that we will not have this personality cult. Because, you know, we have a saying that a person who does a thing again and again can be considered a stupid person. I suppose that we are not stupid people. I hope that we should learn from our experiences. For the longest time, we have had a system that has been has had crippling effects on our economy, on our society. And because of this, up to now, we haven't really attained that level of progress and development that we wanted to attain. So it's high time that we should embrace the concept of change, because there's nothing that is permanent in this world except change, Danisa. And I hope that we will no longer abide by what we call the personality cult. It should be issues-oriented. And that is another reason why I'm advocating for parliamentary federalism. Because I believe, and I strongly believe in mind and in heart, that people living in the cities, urban areas, do not have the monopoly of intelligence, knowledge, skills, experience. We give way to those people in the far-flung areas, in the provinces, because many of those people are bright and intelligent, but they do not have the opportunity to shine. Why? Because in politics, what we need here is money. Just like me, I'm sure I would not have a good fighting chance because I don't have the money to really promote myself. I admit, and I am not embarrassed to admit, that I am a poor person. I don't have the financial capability just like the other candidates to support my candidacy. But I am hoping that many of our people who have genuine intentions and who have a good heart, that they will support me so that we will be able to come up with some people who would really be knowledgeable, competent, and who have the commitment to work for our people.
Okay, sir. But I would just like to ask po, if do you have no specific names po, of your contenders, your biggest rivals po?
Well, in the sector of agriculture, we all know that there are some, well, I only know of one person who is trying to promote agriculture as well. But the thing is, it's good that we have a different kind of perspective. Because my issue when it comes to agriculture is more on the giving away of lands. For the other candidate, what he wants is to promote agriculture in a different way, in a different manner. I hope you don't mind that I would not mention his name anymore because I don't want to create enemies. I only want to create friends. Danisa.
Okay, so now po, gonna ask lang po that during the COC filing, you filed under PDP Laban po, correct?
Right.
So sir, what can you say po about the internal rift of the party po?
Internal rift of the party?
Yes, because the party was split into two.
Yeah, parties. I know. You know, that is an issue which is sub judice right now. When you say sub judice, it's pending. It still has to be resolved by the COMELEC, and it would be probably released by November 15 or at a later date. So I would not want to delve on this, but you know, the PDP Laban on the Kusi wing, because you call them the Kusi wing side, which I am affiliated with, are actually have the support of the majority of the members of the PDP Laban. Secondly, the presidential candidate, supposedly for the wing belonging to Senator, well, anyway, the faction that belongs to Manny Pacquiao, he already ran under a new political party, which is the Provinciano, I suppose, I think. And because of that, they have already forfeited the right to fight for PDP Laban because that would be violative of the provisions of the constitution and bylaws of PDP Laban.
Okay, cool, sir. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque earlier said po na President Duterte is considering to also join the senatorial race. What is your thought on this po?
Well, the president is a lawyer and he was once a congressman. He has an experience when it comes to legislation. And I think there would be no problem with that because even the former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, who was, of course, our president also ran for the Congress. And so what would prohibit President Duterte to run for the senatorial position? There is no law that prohibits him from doing that. But of course, it is his option. But if I am in the position of the president, because I want to enjoy life, and probably I want to relax if I were in that position. But you know, the president has a real love for public service, and we should respect him for his decisions, if at all he runs for a Senate seat.
Okay, sir. So for this part, sir, I'm going to ask, I'm going to tell some certain issues po and just tell us if you are in favor or not, or just your thoughts about it po, sir.
Sure.
Po, since you were the former secretary, what is your thoughts po on agrarian reform? Earlier po, you said that there are still 380,000 hectares of land yet to be given. Is this on track po, on the timeline, or is there a delay in this po?
Let me just clarify. It's not actually, as per my memory, if my memory serves me right, there is still around 520,000 hectares of land to be distributed. Now, 100,000 hectares of which are already assigned to BARM. And it's the farm function of the BARM to distribute the 100 hectares. Now, the 300,000 hectares are actually problematic lands. When you say problematic, it's riddled with a lot of legal issues because it's either the farmers are fighting it out amongst themselves, or the landlord is fighting with the farmers, and would intervene in order to protect the interests of the farmers. So that's how it is. The only thing that is already, that's still clean to be distributed would be around 100,000 hectares, more or less. Now, but then, I'd just like to give due credit to the administration, because under the administration of President Duterte, there was an executive order that was passed, EO-75, wherein idle government-owned lands with an inventory of around 230,000 hectares can still be distributed. Danisa. And this came about during my term, my incumbency. I was the one who recommended to the president for the passage of an executive order number 75, meaning these are all either government-owned lands owned by some departments, agencies, which are not being used and utilized for the purpose that it was intended. So we get it, we parcelize it, and we distribute it for free to the farmers. And there's an inventory of around 230,000 hectares. But what is 230,000 hectares if we have a population of 110 million people? It's not enough. That's the reason why it is my advocacy that we extend the Comprehensive Agrarian Reform Program by extending the notice of coverage, and we should come up with an improved and a new and a more dynamic Comprehensive Agrarian Reform Program to cater not only to farmers but all sectors of society who are underprivileged and can be given the opportunity to really improve their lives.
Okay, sir. So next po is substitution policy. Are you in favor of this po, or do you think it could be abused?
Well, substitution policy became very prominent during the term of President Duterte. And it became successful because eventually he was elected as the president. There are no... Well, of course, that would depend on how it is used. If it is abused, then definitely it's not good. But for me, since the law so allows substitution at the moment, from a legal point of view, then it should continue. But if there is a discontentment amongst our people, feeling that it is being abused, then definitely we can legislate a law in order to prohibit the substitution. Well, there are some sectors of our society who are calling for the abolition of the substitution clause under our COMELEC clause. And later on, during the deliberation in the Senate, in the Congress, probably if they find that it is really being abused, then definitely it should be abolished. But as of now, being a lawyer, this is the law, so the law must be implemented. There is a saying, there's a dictum, the law may be harsh, but it is the law, so we have to entertain that law. And we must have to implement the same.
Okay, sir. So now for COVID-19 response, are you satisfied with the government's response po on the COVID-19 pandemic?
Well, basically right now, we already were able to at least control the spread of COVID-19. I think if I'm not mistaken, there are only around 2,000 plus which are now infected with the virus. So that means that we are quite successful with this. But honestly, during the early onset of the COVID-19, it seems as if we are confronting the issue there's so much anarchy, a misunderstanding. But of course, eventually we were able to learn on how to respond positively and efficiently through the COVID-19. But this is not only a situation that occurred in our country. Even in other countries, they also had that kind of problem. Even the United States, European countries, even India, which is supposedly a very powerful country, had so much problem with the Delta variant. So what I'm saying is that it is a new and a peculiar disease. It's a novelty, so to speak, that nobody knew how to respond to it immediately. But I think right now we are responding positively and we are efficient in our response because of the granular lockdown. Because before, when there was an infection, we closed the whole municipality or the whole city or the whole region. But the infectation only took place in a certain barangay. So why not just concentrate in one barangay, which is, of course, the concept of a granular lockdown. So basically, I'm saying is that we are learning as we go on. And I think that is very good. Sorry. And that is very good. And I suppose that we continue with our responses. And of course, this cannot be done, not unless there would be a cooperation amongst the citizenry. That is the only way, the best way, that we will be able to confront this problem.
Okay, sir. So now po that fuel prices are soaring po, what is your take on fuel excise tax suspension?
Well, basically what I'm saying is that we need to think about the welfare of the people, you know? And the consumers, of course, more especially at this height of the pandemic, when the prices of fuel are so high, definitely we have to think of a way on how to lower it down so that we will be able to help the common people. You know, a lot of people are suffering these days because of the pandemic. I see a lot of beggars in the streets right now.
Okay, so are you in favor with
that? It means that a lot of people lost their jobs. Why not? Why not? Why don't we suspend it so that the prices would really go down?
Okay, sir. So now, how about the West Philippine Sea issue po? In case po, what is your stand on, or how will you address it po?
You know, modesty aside, I had a course of international law in the University of Notre Dame in London, in United Kingdom. And one of the issues that, one of the subject matter that we extensively discuss about is the laws of the sea. And we all know that we have two confronting issues here, two opposite issues being advanced by our country, which adhere to the archipelagic doctrine. And the other one is with respect to the so-called nine dash line, which is being, adhered to by the People's Republic of China. You know, it would be difficult to engage in international diplomacy if you are a weak country. It's difficult. I'll give you an example in Lessons of History, Danica. If you remember, World War One, what was the basis of it all? The Treaty of Versailles. And Germany was trying to reclaim a property which they believe is theirs. And later on, the war broke out, and you know the result was a devastating loss of Germany. And thereafter, it was in the Second World War that Germany was able to learn from its debacle, from the lessons of history. What did they do? Before they continued to fight for the claim of their so-called territories, what they did was that they prepared themselves economically. They prepared their government so that they would be able to have the unity of the people, and they strengthened their army or their armed forces. But of course, the person who did this was Adolf Hitler. But I'm not idolizing Adolf Hitler. All that I'm saying is that he had the so-called expertise to really move the country into unison so that they would be able to fight for their rights. And they were, however, successful in the end because partly they became a very powerful country. In the same manner, what I'm saying is that if we want to pursue our claims in terms of territories, it will be difficult for the international community to hear us if we are weak, if we don't have the power. So for the meantime that we don't have the power, what we must concentrate on is to strengthen our government, to strengthen our economy, to strengthen our people and motivate them to have genuine nationalism so that they would be able to, we would be able to amass the support and the resources that is needed to fight for these territories. Look at what had happened with our claim on Sabah. Is it not? I have a paper on this in the international, which was published in one of the papers, in the universities. Not fight for it. Why? Because we don't have the capability to fight for it. So we just rested our case and we are waiting for the opportunity that we will be able to get it back. In the same manner, the West Philippine Sea, we are confronted with a country more powerful than ours. Will they hear us? Will they hear us out? Our voices will be drowned because of their strength, their power, their economy, etc., etc. And to think that we are dealing with them when it comes to economic negotiations, we buy from them. Sometimes we are dependent on them because of the work of our people in China and also it's difficult to fight for an issue when you are weak. There's a saying, you negotiate when you're strong, because if you are weak, it's difficult to negotiate.
Okay po, sir. So now what is your take po on war on drugs?
Well, did you know, Danisa, during the height of the campaign of the administration against war on drugs, did you know that I was then an undersecretary of the DILG? And my main preoccupation was to supervise the construction of the mega rehabs and the different rehabilitation centers throughout the Philippines. And that's what I believe in, rehabilitation. But of course, we cannot blame the policy of the administration because some of the managers and some of those policymakers deemed it wise that we should concentrate on the law implementation, on the police action, But in my case, I did my part in order to complement the efforts by supervising the construction of rehabilitation centers because I strongly believe that everybody should be given a second chance. We can rehabilitate people. That's my belief. And everybody must be respected. There must be some dignity that can be given to any person, whoever they are. And to rehabilitate them for me is very important.
So what can you say po about the International Criminal Court's investigation on the crimes against humanity po in related to this war on drugs?
Well, it's a process that it's ongoing. These people have the right, but President Duterte has also the right to defend himself. And I think it would be difficult for us, or it would be unfair for us to make a judgment now that the process is ongoing. All that I can say is that both sides have a line of defense or a line of thinking that would have to promote their respective interest. And it's the right of both parties to really pursue their point of interest. But for President Duterte, my position for him is that, he did not do it personally. And sometimes the problem is, there are those people who implement the law and they overdo it. And because of that, there are abuses. And the president is very open when it comes to the prosecution of those people really responsible for having caused the injustices, killing people, mercilessly, so to speak. But I don't want to make a lengthy comment on this, but what I just can say is that it's ongoing, so let's respect it, because there's a saying that when a case is sub judice, it's still pending, we cannot make comments that are, well, siding the both parties.
Okay, so sir, for the following topics that I'm gonna say, just tell us if you're in favor or not of it.
Okay.
Okay, so same-sex marriage.
Not in favor.
Could you tell us a brief explanation po why?
Well, you know, same-sex marriage, we're talking about marriage. Under our law, under Persons and Family Code, marriage is union between male and female. And definitely, there's no law that would have to justify the marriage of persons belonging to the same sex. So if we want to change this, let's draft a law. Let's craft a law that allows it. But for now, it's not allowed. No matter how these people would like to have it, but the law does not provide it, it would become illegal. It would become illegal. So that's the bottom line of that of it. But you know, if we hear the position of Pope Francis, definitely his position, because his position is that same-sex marriage under the concept of the church is never allowed. But with respect to the civil aspect of it, it depends on the government, whether they would recognize it or not. But the thing that is very important, which I think we should be able to bear in mind, is that people who belong to the same sex must be respected when it comes to their decisions. Not really marriage, but same-sex union, probably, because nobody can stop them. And we should protect their companionship, or for as long as they should not be promiscuous. And secondly, with regards to the property regime, that should be respected also, because there are already couples belonging to the same sex who are living together and they have amassed some sort of a property, and they should be respected for that. But with regards to the marriage, well, the thing is, up to now, there is no law that allows it, so we cannot do otherwise.
Okay, sir. How about divorce?
Divorce, you know, we are in a Catholic country, Danisa, and divorce is never allowed. But if the government later on, because it would be the effort of many legislators, it will be voted upon in a plenary whether they would allow divorce or not. But if at all there would be a law proposed for a divorce, my position is I would not go for it.
Because we're a Catholic country, Paul.
We are a Catholic country. We're a Christian country. And definitely, this is contrary to the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay, so I guess your stand on abortion is also not in favor in this case, po.
You got it.
Sir, how about charter change?
Charter change. I definitely agree with charter change. It is high time for us to have our constitution be amended or totally overhauled. You know why? Because, you know, for the longest time that we have been embracing a constitution that is not, well, that is no longer relevant to our people's need. I think we have to bear in mind that the only thing that is constant or permanent is change. So we have to somehow entertain the concept of change. Most especially for me, I have been advocating for the longest time parliamentary federalism. You know, Danisa, parliamentary federalism. I was able to study abroad, and I had an international law on comparative government. And you know, most of the countries that are well-developed and are very progressive have this parliamentary federalism. You know, the good thing about parliamentary, especially in England, is that when we have a ruler who cannot govern the country effectively, even if he just stayed there for 1 to 2 months, if the people would not like him, we can boot him out, kick him out, so to speak, so that we can choose we can establish a new government that would adhere to the needs of the people. But, you know, if a ruler, or should I say the person at the helm of the government, is highly effective and he fulfills his role of addressing the welfare of the people, then definitely he can stay there for as long as he wants, for as long as the people wants him to stay there. And then the second issue about parliamentary federalism is that, you know, for the longest time, our country is based on personality cult. You know, the people who are manning the helm of our government are people who are popular. Not that I have anything against actors, actresses, or people who excel in different fields of endeavors, but, you know, well, I strongly believe that we should be issue-oriented rather than personality-oriented. Because how can they run a country, the affairs of the country, which is so complicated, wherein there is a bureaucracy that you have to deal with. You have to deal with the international diplomacy, etc., and put a person there who does not even understand the issues related to these matters. Then he will just be used by the people around him. They will just influence him. And the people who will be making the decisions are those people around him. And that is not correct. It should be a person, the backer at the person who makes the decision, and not only those people all around him. That's the reason why I strongly believe that it is high time for us to have a federal parliamentary form of government. Thirdly, you know, the most important aspect of change in our economy, society, is the economy. It's high time that we should adopt an effective economic program. We know that we are a democratic country. We can only be democratic if there are a lot of investments coming in our country. And what stops the investments come from coming in? Maybe let's take a glance again at our constitution, wherein there's a provision there which states that 60% must be owned by the Filipinas, etc., for corporations. Other countries do not have this, and yet our apprehensions that the foreigners will be the one that running the affairs of our economy, I don't think it doesn't have any solid basis at all, because those other countries which do not have this provision in their constitution are very progressive. A lot of people are really benefiting from this economic progress that they have. So I think we must have to rethink all of these positions, because our apprehensions are not grounded, they don't have any basis at all, and so we must entertain change, charter change, so to speak.
Okay, sir. So now po, how about death penalty reimposition po? This is kind of related to the Catholic Church.
I am against death penalty. Why? Because I believe in the sanctity of life. And also, I believe in the saying that a society is judged on how the strong treat the weak in their society. And so, if we adopt death penalty, but of course there are exemptions because nothing is absolute. Probably if it's a heinous crime, something that really deserves immediate concern, because it affects the public, etc., that may be allowed. But as a general rule, for me, my position is death penalty is not to be entertained.
Okay po, sir. So may I know your thoughts po on the historical revisionism on martial law?
There's a saying that whenever events take place in a society, it will always be the person holding the pen that writes history. Those people who are influential, those people who are well off, rich, and educated. You know, there's a a position right now that there is an ongoing historical revisionism because of the coming back of some people who were actually removed from their positions before. You know, my position there is that it can only happen if the people will be submissive and if the people would remain to be docile and would not lift a finger to oppose the so-called historical revisionism. We have a lot of people who are intelligent in our country, a lot of intellectuals, some of whom are coming from the University of the Philippines and even in other universities for that matter. So they are the ones who would be able to wage opposition to this historical revisionism. So let's not just put it in the hands of the government. It must be an effort that must be undertaken by people who are intellectuals, those who are in the academe, those who have the power and the authority to sway influence amongst our people and who writes history because of their knowledge, their skills, and their position and influence.
Okay, sir. Well, when it comes to employment, are you in favor or against of end of contractualization or ENDO?
I'm against it because it would be unjust to our laborers. You know, the backbone of the society are the laborers. We must be able to help them so that at least they would have the dignity of really being considered as laborers and people who are really helping shape up the economy of our country. So my position is, yeah, I don't go for contractualization.
Okay, sir. How about press freedom po? Do you believe press freedom is alive?
Definitely. Press freedom or the fourth estate must be respected. It will only be the only factor that would prove that our country is truly democratic. We should give the press the so-called freedom because that is enshrined in our constitution. Press freedom. And so definitely you must have to respect it. Because that is the only way wherein we can come up with a healthy society if there is press freedom.
Okay, but do you believe, sir, that it is alive? Because there are killings po eh. Some journalists were reported to be killed po.
There are so many sectors in our society that are actually, as I know, involved in the killing of these press people. Those who have been probably affected by unfavorable press reports. So it would be utterly wrong to accuse of violating press freedom because of the many killings of our press people. But definitely, I wish that these people, if they are caught, they must be held accountable and be punished severely for what they're doing. And killing the press people because it is a violation. It's in violation of our constitution.
Do you think that the Philippines is doing enough to address climate change?
I think it's enough. It's the traditional use of energy, which is of course fuel, carbon based, to transition into the so-called renewable energy. But we should start doing so if we want to really help our country preserve our environment. Remember, environment must be the concern of all people, not only individuals, but of all the people. Because we have seen, we have been a witness to the natural calamities about by our mistreating our environment. I think it's high time that we must be educated and must know that it is the prime duty of every citizen to see to it that the environment must be well. The leadership must come, or the initiative must come from the government, because by doing so, we will be able to influence our people. And besides, it's the government which has the vast resource power in order to see to it that the environment is well protected.
So now, last question for you po. Why should the people vote for you?
Alam niyo po mga minamahal kong kababayan, Ako po si Brother John Castriciones. Hindi po ako politiko. Wala din po akong maraming pera para pangampanya. Pero naniniwala po ako na pwede po nating makamta ng pagbabago kung tayo po ay tapat sa ating pagmamahal sa ating bansa at sa ating mga mamamayang Pilipino. Ako po ay nag-advocacy ng isang konsepto ng revolusyon. Ang tawag ko po dito internal revolution. Na sana, kung gusto natin po ng totoong pagbabago, baguhin natin ang ating puso, baguhin natin ang ating isipan, at gumawa tayo ng tama na nakakabuti sa lahat ng mamamayan at sa ating bansa. Tandaan po natin, iisa lamang po ang bansa natin, at ito po ay magiging progresibo at magkakaroon ng kapayapaan kung tayo po mismo ay magbago at maging tapat sa ating tungkulin bilang mga Pilipino. Sana po magkaisa po tayo sa darating na eleksyon, mamili po tayo ng tama yung mga taong may pagmamahal sa ating bayan at pagmamahal sa bansang Pilipinas at siyempre sa ating mamayang Pilipino. Maraming salamat po at magandang araw po sa inyo lahat. Danisa, thank you so much for this opportunity and I'd like to thank INQUIRER for this.
Okay, sir, thank you so much din po as well. And that is senatorial aspirant John Castriciones. I'm Danisa Fernandez and this is INQside Look.